baptism. I'm here for communion, and now I'm having a chance to preach for you this morning. And you become familiar people, familiar faces to me, and that makes it all the better as I share the Word of God with you this morning. The heading is The Calling of the First Disciples. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, with the people crowding around him and listening to the Word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of them, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put the boat out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. Thanks be to God for his gracious message to us. One of my earliest memories was of going fishing with my dad on one of the fishing piers on Lake Erie at Gordon Park in Cleveland. I was probably, maybe 4 or 5 years old. There we were, Dad with his fishing pole, and me with mine sitting on the cement pier. Mine was one of those plastic models. They still have them. I've seen them now. Some are Tinkerbell and all sorts of wonderful Disney characters on them. Well, mine was a great fishing pole. Up until that time, I had spent most of the time fishing on our front lawn. You can imagine what that would have been like. At some point, when I was really getting into the spirit of things, my pole left my hands all together and ended up in the lake. My dad was able to fish it out, and it actually turned out to be the best catch of our day. Now flash forward some 40 plus years, and Don, my husband, and I are deep fishing off the Florida Keys with Don's family. I was one seasick puppy, but every time it was my turn to fish, I got up and caught a fish. Then I'd go back and throw up and wait my turn again until it was my turn to get up and catch a fish and back to throwing up again. You can see how my day was. It was memorable for many reasons. But you know, the one good thing that came out of it was that I had won the respect of my father-in-law. He saw me trying so hard to be a part of things. And I never could let that down, and that was a good thing. But it wasn't until we became proud owners of a small place on Indian Lake and actually had a pontoon boat there that I began to give much thought, real thought, about fishing. I've been reading up on the subject, and I thought I might learn something helpful from the stories of Jesus and his fishermen disciples. You know, all four Gospels have versions of the call of the first disciples in them. They were called from their work, some of them, as fishermen. But the story as it is found in Luke provides a fuller picture as it focuses in on the reaction of one of the disciples, Simon, who we later call Peter. In the 11 lines, there is much to learn about Simon Peter and ourselves, about fishing and faith. Now, unlike most fish stories, which tend to be brag sessions about who caught the longest fish or how the big one got away, this is a different kind of fish story. It's about fishermen coming up empty after fishing all night, and about a carpenter who commandeers a boat, preaches a sermon, and tells the fishermen where to fish. Jesus has just finished fishing, teaching, and speaking to the growing crowds of people from Simon's boat. And then he turns to Simon and he says, "Put out into the deep water for a catch." Simon's response had to be one of restrained frustration. "Sir, we have been fishing all night and have caught nothing." In other words, "Listen, buddy, we do this for a living, not just on weekends. Maybe you should go back to the carpenter's shop." Why St. Simon Peter agrees to row out into the deeper water, we do not know. He had no clue that he had on his boat Jesus, who might be called the first century equivalent to GPS and fish finder. Perhaps he did so because he was learning to trust Jesus. Perhaps he did it to humor him. Perhaps he did it to show him wrong. Perhaps it was because of something of Jesus' tone of voice. Whatever the reason, Simon Peter chooses to row out into the deeper water, and the rest is history. Nets were bursting, boats sinking with fish, Simon falling on his knees before Jesus, and a charge given: "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." And when they had brought their boats to the shore, they left everything, their nets and boats, and a fresh catch of fish, families, careers, and a lifetime of training, safety, comfort, and a stable life. They left everything to follow Jesus. This is not your Uncle Gary's kind of fish story, and yet there are lessons to be learned from it. "Put out into deep water," Jesus told Simon. "Let's leave the shallows and go to the deep." Everyone knows that schools of big fish are in the deeper water. And the first rule of fishing is you've got to go where the fish are. But we shouldn't limit this thought to fish only. Jesus was talking about our life in faith. We could substitute fish for wisdom or grace, loving, healing, peace, and so much more. All those things we want in abundance. Deep water is where the increase is. Deep water takes faith. Deep water is a risk. Focus of mind and heart are needed. The visible ability in deep water is next to nothing. You've got to trust the words and directions of others who have passed through deep water before you. Jesus is always inviting people to go deeper into things. But shallow water is pleasant. It tickles our ankles when we walk in. The minnows and the half-grown fish gather there. You can see it all the way to the bottom in shallow water. Staying in the shallow water is such a temptation. It feels so good. Shallow water doesn't cost much. It doesn't take a whole lot of courage. But Simon knew the minnows couldn't feed him. They couldn't fill him. The minnows weren't the desirable catch of his heart. The deep water of faith is where those things we say we want are swimming around. The shallow is where we begin the adventure, not where we finish. There is a time for classes and listening, and a time to live what we've learned, a time to receive, and a time to give sacrificially, a time to worship, and a time to be in church out in the world. Deep water is where we have to go to find what God has for us to do. Sometimes we need to be stimulated by someone who lives outside our frame of reference. And surely, Simon Peter got stimulated that day with Jesus. Sometimes we need to listen to another point of view. Sometimes we need to risk one more failure to go and do what our common sense tells us cannot be done, and to try what we know will not work. Sometimes we need to head out into the deep waters and let down our nets for no better reason than Jesus has asked us to do so. Jim Panhale writes, "The image that strikes me in today's gospel is not the fishing, but the reluctance of Simon to break out of the ordinary and the everyday ways of thinking and doing. I've always been attracted to Simon Peter because he's so much like many of us. Well, at least like me. Despite firsthand, I don't think it's being suggested that our mission is to put out bait and catch unsuspecting fish that might be curious enough to nibble. I think the reading might suggest that we should be willing to set the familiar aside and be unafraid to try new waters. Jesus did not come simply to make each one of us into some kind of metaphorical fisherman. Going out to catch souls with a line of faith so that they could be displayed in some heavenly trophy case. He came so each one of us might have an abundant life, a full and rich life, a life in which we know and experience and share the love of God, a love which conquers the sting of death, and ensures that in the end our labors are not in vain, no matter how many days our nets may come up empty. Expect a catch. Expect to make a catch. When Jesus tells Simon, "Let's go to the deep water," he doesn't stop there. He says, "Prepare for a catch." What an encouragement. There is a word for all of us here who go to church on Sunday morning. Week after week, we go to the water, the deep water of worship. But do we go preparing for a catch? Do we go to church with expectations, believing that a blessing is just there, waiting for each one of us? Or do we go to appease a spouse, or to be seen by others, or out of habit? Expectations count with God. It's all over the Bible. Expectation is the substance of things hoped for. No expectation, no real faith. When we say we believe in God, we are not saying I am agreeing with some abstract idea. We're saying we expect the things that God has promised to us. We're saying, I'm a partner with the giver of every good gift. And among those gifts, Jesus, God has promised through Jesus the fruitfulness, fish, and forever. I like how Jesus keeps pushing Simon's boundaries. Leave the shore, Simon. Go into the deep, Simon. These are easy in comparison to expect a blessing, Simon. God knows more about fish than you, and certainly me. Some people think that they know more about fish than God. Simon almost makes that mistake. He tells Jesus in that exasperated tone, hey, we've been fishing all night. We know fish. Aren't you a carpenter, moonlighting as a preacher anyway? Now, we might be able to give Simon the benefit of the doubt. He was just getting to know Jesus. But the same thing happens to all of us. And we have a Bible and 2,000 years of our Christian tradition to learn from. It's not that we actually think we know more than God. It's just that we behave that way sometimes. We hear God's instructions. Forgive one another. Bless those who curse you. Give abundantly. Remember the Sabbath day. It's for worship and family, not for catching up on work. But we ignore God's invitation to abundance. We say to God by our actions, we know more about life, more about healing, more about forgiveness, more about children, more about money than you do, God. Simon, for just a split second, forgets that God is God. And then at that crucial moment in time, faced by frustration and failure, Simon decided that he didn't know everything, and he was ready to listen. Another thing, before you venture into deep water, be sure to take your safety equipment. Well, in this day and age, we have personal flotation devices, otherwise known as life vests. We have anchors, a signal flag, a horn, running and anchor lights at night, all of which are by law expected to be carried with us and used when we're out on the lake. In 1986, archaeologists found a first century boat from the Sea of Galilee. It was about 26.5 feet long, 7.5 feet wide, and 4.5 feet deep, high. It gives us a pretty good idea of the size of Simon Peter's fishing boat. The boat was plenty deep. It would have held a lot of fish, and would have taken a lot to sink it. In Simon's days, there were no fancy equipment, perhaps an anchor, and of course, oars with which to row it. Out there with Jesus, Simon only had his skill and his growing faith in God and the companionship of Jesus to see him through. Even though we do have safety equipment available today, that faith and trust in God and companionship of Jesus remain essential for us, whether our journey of faith takes us on land or sea or even in the air. It is still to be seen how adept at being fisher people Don and I will turn out to be. So far, the great blue herons and ospreys and bald eagles around the lake are doing a much better job. The story of Jesus and his fishermen disciples encourages me. And I hope it encourages you as well. As we venture forth into the waters of life, we do so well to heed the instructions of the one who remains our true GPS and fish finder, as he gives direction to us through scripture and here in our hearts. As we labor to let down and bring up our nets, may we all discover the fullness of life which God has intended for each one of us.